200 kilowatts and 3 megawatts of capacity G32 rate, right? Minus some of the set charges like your monthly and your monthly just flat charge and demand charges and transmission charges, things like that. It comes out to a flat fee of, I think, 11.4 cents a kilowatt hour is what I came up with the folks I've been working with. And so they can do that. And I think that's what they've been trying to do, although I've heard a different story about that recently as well. Jamestown could do the same thing, either here, Taylor Point, or Fort Getty. Doesn't matter. So if the two wind resources were exactly the same, you did it that way, the result would be exactly the same. The problem is, if you do it behind the meter, then it's a slightly different structure. What you're then saying is that you want to adhere to offsetting specific load. If you choose that option, the way the legislation is written right now, you can offset up to 10 loads. Behind the meter at one of them, and I think up to 10 other meters at a slightly reduced compensation from the actual offset at the behind the meter one. And that has got to be considered net metering, right? Because you're actually net metering at one site and then offsetting 10 other sites. What happens to the load, the power produced after that, I'm not actually sure at this point. Nobody's tried that yet. I don't know if Corinna, if you know the answer to that one, but
I'm gonna have to look at the log again, but I think the assumption has been all along that if the net excess generation is more than the load of the, that there's nothing in the law that speaks to the load of the town at all, so that would be irrelevant. We can still get the full value.
Okay.
Up to 3.5.
As long as the project is 3.5.
Right.
I thought that the.
Okay, the net meter. Okay.
The first meter. You still can talk to the first meter even if you're not asking for the net billing. You're just getting the check. You still have that first one offset and then the rest. I'll double check that.
Yeah, and I think that's all yet to be determined because nobody's actually tried it yet. Portsmouth is getting close to resolving that. But the last I heard from Gary Gump is that National Grid was cutting them a check so far. They've gotten a check, and I have yet to find out what it actually said on it based on the power produced. And we'll know exactly what they're actually thinking. But with that said,
in Portsmouth, if they're, you know, that's as a result of the fair metering, or they have the behind the meter?
They are numbers. They are not behind the meter
anymore, so they moved out in front.
Definitely.
Okay, because I think that's something that when I was looking at their numbers, I got confused because it almost doesn't show that, well, we're not being billed for this electric bill. So say their monthly charge is like $10,000, but they don't show that because they don't show it. But it comes off a different line out of their budget. They're not paying $10,000 a month for electricity charge over here, but it's not being credited to their wind generator over here.
Right. You just get a check for the production.
Right.
Right.
You have to pay your electric bill.
You still have to pay the electric bill, right.
Right. Whereas in the traditional net metering thing, your electric meter runs backwards, goes to zero, and then goes positive,
right.
and then you get money for the left.
But I think that's what Portsmouth was doing with behind the meter
Yes.
They weren't actually getting a check.
But since
they were also not paying.
Right.
But since they were running it at a school, the school wasn't using power
right.
on
that, that's what I'm saying, it doesn't come off the other line. So in the budgeting, you have to show that line come over
right.
and say we zeroed out 10,000 a month. So we're in a footnote saying 10,000 a month or an extra line that says, with all of this said and done, it brings in 200,000 a year. However, it's really 320 because we have 10,000 a month times 12.
Yeah. So, yeah.
There's different ways of accounting for it.
So you put your assumptions down, obviously.
But, well, they're in there already.
I mean, for the new figures, you'll just reinforce your assumptions.
Right. They haven't changed. Because our view of the law hasn't changed. I can't describe it accurately. Anybody else? Can you state your name?
Yeah, I'm Kathy Rohman. I'm with the Conservation Commission. And I just came to drop off a memo that we had prepared. The Conservation Commission, if you guys don't know, Bob does too, and the committee knows. We've been involved with the Wind Committee a little bit since the inception, and there's an environmental component to the feasibility study. I don't know if you guys have had a chance to take a look at it. The group was really terrific. They consulted with the Conservation Commission. We had some input in it. The consultant who prepared it met with the Conservation Commission, got feedback from our two bird experts on the commission, Carol Trockey and Chris Powell, and some feedback from Candy Powell, who does some bird counts here on the island and so forth. As you may know, there's not a whole wealth of information surrounding environmental issues pertaining to wind turbines, particularly locally, in spite of the fact that we've got the Portsmouth turbines, and of course, the issues related to environmental birds, bats, and so forth, even in Portsmouth, are going to be a little bit different compared to what we've got here in Jamestown. So, in addition to what was compiled and prepared in the environmental component of the feasibility report, the Conservation Commission hired a URI student, a graduate student in the Department of Natural Resources Science, to do a bat study. And she's collected some data, and so we're reporting on that in this memo that I'll leave with you all. She recorded basically the number of bats that she could find at the three sites that were identified in the study, Beavertail, Fort Getty, and Taylor Point, and found that there is significant bat activity at all three sites, not statistically different between the three sites. Now, unfortunately, she's not tall enough, and neither is the equipment to really notice how high up the bats go, that they are nearly as high as what you would have with the turbine. And we don't yet know the diversity of the species, so whether or not the species fall into any categories that we need to be concerned about, that part of the study is still ongoing, and I think will probably continue to be ongoing for a little while longer. But at least we know that there are some, we know that there are some bats at those sites, so it's something that we need to kind of keep a little bit of an eye on. And then based on some personal knowledge of both Chris and Carol Trockey, they are thinking that Taylor Point would have a slightly higher potential risk for birds because of the migratory pattern of the flyway of the wetlands and the waterfowl. They're going between Jamestown and over to the Middletown area. But there's no qualitative or quantitative study that really backs that up at this point in time. So this is just based on their own knowledge and something that people should be aware of. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention and something that you can, you know, be thinking about in conjunction with the environmental component of the feasibility study. And I'll leave this with you guys when the meeting breaks up.
Thank you.
I have a reply for you. Yeah. University of Calgary scientists have discovered a way to reduce bat deaths at wind turbines. And they've discovered that it's at low speeds. I guess, let's see. Bats their lungs, their bodies are unable to accommodate a change in pressure, low pressure changes. So the scientists there have figured out a way to help with decrease bat deaths. So I have an article for you.
Okay.
As part of the wind turbine study.
We actually didn't say anything about bats dying. We just said that we recorded that there were bats around there. We didn't say anything that they had been dying there. We just said that they lived in that area.
Guess they say here, a groundbreaking study shed new light on the reasons for bat deaths under wind turbines in this particular creek area. Researchers found that the majority of migratory bats in the southern Alberta location were killed because a sudden drop of air pressure near the blades caused injuries to the bat lungs, known as barotrauma. Although the respiratory system in birds can withstand such drops in pressure, the physiology of bat lungs doesn't allow for a sudden change in pressure. So then they figured out how to accommodate the circumstances. So it's just interesting.
Okay. I was out for 2 minutes, so maybe this has been brought up. But one thing I'm concerned about is noise for neighbors, and noise hasn't been mentioned tonight at all. And I just this morning, coincidentally, I got an email from my friend in Vinyl, who sent me an article about what's the controversy there. They have 3 1.5 megawatt turbines that were recent, well, within the last year were installed.